Praise God. Any good to be in the Lord's house this morning? Now that was awful quiet. Isn't it good to be in the Lord's house this morning? Next week there will not be any decaf. It's all going to be full of caffeine. I want you to wait for these services. We're glad you're here this morning. Our ushers are going to come and we're going to give you an opportunity to worship the Lord with your giving this morning. And as you do, I would encourage you to drop in that little card that you just filled out with your name, your information, prayer requests on it. The Lord will bless that time. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for giving us the strength to be here today. Thank you, Father, for helping us, Lord, to, Lord, walk in your strength. And Lord, thank you for bringing us to this house, Father. Lord, I pray that you bless this time of giving, that you bless your people. As they give back a portion of what you poured into their life, I pray, Lord, you bless it. You meet all the needs. God, help us as a church and help us as individuals, Lord, to be good stewards of what you poured into our life. For that, we'll give you praise in Jesus' name. And everyone said,
Amen. Amen.
Story, even. There is this whole idea of dedicating children to the Lord. The Bible tells us in Luke chapter 2, verse 21, 8 days later, talking about Jesus, when the baby was circumcised, he was named Jesus, the name given to him by the angel, even before he was conceived. And then it was time for the purification offering as required by the law of Moses after the birth of a child. So his parents took him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. The law of the Lord says a woman's first child is a boy. He must be dedicated to the Lord. So they offered the sacrifice required by the law of the Lord, either a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Jesus himself was brought before a priest in the house of the Lord and dedicated to the Lord. And there's a very familiar passage of Scripture. I know you all know this. One day Jesus was ministering and people brought their kids to Jesus. And the disciples, being stick in the mud, funny duds, taking on the nature of religious zealots, said, "Get those children out of here." And it's recorded in the Word of God. One day some parents brought their children to Jesus so he could lay his hands on them and pray for them. But the disciples scolded the parents for bothering him. But Jesus said, "Let the children come to me. Don't stop them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to those who are like these children." And he placed his hands on their heads, and he blessed them before he left. I want to say to you that the Bible makes it very clear that we should give our children to the Lord in dedication. This morning, on a church platform much like this one, Colorado Springs, Colorado, my daughter, who's 21 years old, is helping in a choir. She's singing for the glory of the Lord this morning. She's singing to the Lord and for the Lord this morning. But it didn't start there. It started on a platform like this about 21 years ago when we invited the pastor who performed our wedding ceremony to come to the church I was pastoring and dedicate our baby girl to the Lord. We gave her to the Lord that day. I'm still giving her to the Lord. And I want to tell you that as Dave and Mandy have come to present their baby to the Lord, I think there's a smile on the face of God. And I believe that it honors the Lord. The Bible makes it clear that the family is a divine institution ordained by God from the very beginning of time. The Bible says that children are a gift from the Lord. They're a heritage of God. And they are committed to parents for care, for protection, and for training. And it's important that parents recognize their obligation and their responsibility before God in this matter. I get requests all the time to dedicate children. Many people say, "Well, Pastor, will you christen my baby? Or Pastor, will you bless my child?" Yeah, I'll bless your child. I'll dedicate your child. We don't baptize children. We believe you need to be baptized when you give your heart and life to Jesus Christ. But this dedication service is really more about the dedication of Dave and Mandy Hall. And it is the prayer that we're going to pray over their precious daughter. Oh my goodness, she's way too cute. Amen. Yeah. Usually I'm holding and I'm totally distracted. Amen. The Bible tells us that Mary brought Jesus to the temple, and now Dave and Mandy recognize the sacredness of their charge as parents, and now they bring back to the Lord this treasure which God has blessed them with. And I want to speak to them, and I want to ask them some questions, and then I want to speak to you, and then I want us all to take responsibility, because I believe God must use us all in raising this little girl to fear and to worship the Lord. David, Mandy, in the sight of God, and in the presence of all of these folks here this morning, do you promise to bring up Charlotte in a way that she will fear and honor the Lord? If you agree to say, amen. Do you promise to teach her and to lead her at the earliest possible age to accept Jesus Christ as her personal Savior? And do you, before the Lord and before these folks, declare that you will teach her the ways of the Lord and live your life in such a way that you are a living example of Jesus before her? Church, I want to challenge you this morning that we have a responsibility. Not just the pastors of this church, but the people who worship here. We all have a responsibility. Before this little girl, to show her the ways of Jesus. And I will just say to you this morning that it will be more by what you do than what you say to her. Now, I would challenge you when you see her to speak kindly to her. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
That was a slow response. Amen. But even louder are your actions. Not just inside the walls of this church, but outside the walls of this church, as she observes you, she sees you. I believe that the Lord wants us all to covenant together, that this child can be raised in such a way that will bring honor and glory to the Lord. Would you stand with me this morning? We're going to offer a prayer of dedication for Chuck. Would be a kiss, by the way. Come on, then. Would you stretch your hands out this way? We're going to pray. We're going to ask God to bless her. We're going to ask God to bless David and Mandy, and I know that the Lord is going to do a great work. Heavenly Father, we thank you today. We praise you today, Lord, for little Charlie, Lord. We thank you, God, for the blessing that she already is. And Father God, we thank you. She is a gift to Dave and Mandy from your hand. You have blessed them, Lord. She is your reward to them. Now, Father, I thank you for these parents who have dedicated themselves today to raise her in the right way, to teach her your ways. And, Father God, to lead her into the way of salvation in Jesus Christ at the earliest possible age. I pray for her now, Lord. I pray you bless her. I pray, Father God, that you would lay your hand upon her. And, Lord, at the earliest possible age, she would put her faith in Jesus Christ. I pray you bless her all the days of her life, Lord. And God, that she would live a life that honors you and blesses you and brings glory to you. May your purposes in her life be fulfilled. And may in every moment and in every way you receive all of the glory through this little girl's life, Lord. As she grows into a woman and to all that you've called her to be, Father, may the name of Christ Jesus forever and always be lifted higher and higher. We thank you today, Lord, for your blessing. We pray you protect her, watch over her, go before her, Lord, lead her, and God bless her, Lord, with many, many years to come. And we'll give you praise and we'll give you glory. For we ask these things in the strong name of Jesus Christ. And everyone said,
Amen.
Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand. Jesus, much like this little one, came to the earth in the form of a baby, but he grew up. And he became the man of God that God called him to be, that God made him to be, that he was going to be, and he fulfilled his mission. You see, it's not just Jesus in a manger. It's Jesus on a cross. It's Jesus shedding his blood for us that makes a difference. Silent Night remains one of the most beloved of the traditional Christmas carols. You will hear it dozens, if not hundreds of times this Christmas. You may sing it a time or two. The words, the tune, the message are all incredibly simple, but incredibly powerful and unforgettable. The picture of Jesus Christ as a child sleeping in heavenly peace amid what was anything but a peaceful place, cows and donkeys and in a feed trough place, the Son of God. Silent Night just doesn't describe his birth, but Silent Night describes an evening that took place, ironically, at the end of Jesus' earthly ministry. It was the night of betrayal, the trial, a series of trials that led to the crucifixion. Like Bethlehem, Jerusalem was buzzing with people, lots of activity. Yet Jesus stood before his accusers in silence. Isaiah the prophet, so many years before this ever happened, wrote these prophetic words in Isaiah 53:7. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, as a sheep before the shearers is silent. So he did not open his mouth. What makes this silence so striking is that Jesus had become quite popular, or maybe some would say quite unpopular, because of all he had to say. He had so much to say about those who were hurting and those who were oppressed. He came to the defense and expressed compassion for those who were outcasts and rejects, the woman caught in adultery, tax collectors, prostitutes, lepers, those suffering physically and spiritually. He spoke out against religious leaders and their hypocrisy, and often he spoke publicly as he prayed to his Father in heaven. And yet on this night, as he stood before his accusers, he was silent. And let me tell you why. He did not come to defend himself. He came to defend you. He did not come to save himself. He came to save you. And in his silence before those accusers, he was sentenced to the cruelest of death. And he died on a cross. As his blood was spilled out, he died on that cross. His body was broken, bruised, beaten. And his very life's blood flowed from his veins as he hung on that cross, suspended between heaven and earth. God's sacrifice on your behalf, on my behalf. And today, on the 2 weeks from Christmas, we are reminded that that sacrifice was for us. In just a moment, our ushers are going to serve you communion. They're going to give you the bread and the cup. And I would simply ask that you hold the bread and the cup until everyone's been served. And we're going to pray. We're going to ask God to help us never forget the great price that was paid. Listen to me. I don't know what you're planning on giving people for Christmas. And I don't know what you're planning on getting for Christmas. But the greatest Christmas gift that was ever given was given by God Himself. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. And that gift is just as real today as it was then. And that gift will still change your life. I'm going to encourage you, as these men serve you, to bow your head and close your eyes before the Lord and just get still before the Lord. How about a little silence in your life? Steel yourself before God and just begin to think about what He's done for you. And take a moment and thank Him. And hold the bread and hold the cup, and we will eat and drink. concerned, just slip your hand up and one of our ushers will take care of you. I want to make sure everyone has been served this morning. We encourage you. Remember with us the Lord has done for you. Thank you, Father.
Father, we thank you and we praise you today for all that you've done for us.
through the gift of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. I pray you bless this bread and this cup to our memory, that we would never forget what you did. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I would encourage you now before the Lord to eat the bread and drink the cup and thank the Lord for what he's done. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Just take a moment and just thank him right now. Just praise him. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for healing me. I give you praise. I give you glory. Amen. Amen. How many of you are glad that we have what we have through Jesus Christ? How many of you are glad we don't have to wait until December the 25th to rip some paper open? We got Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, take your Bibles this morning, if you would, and I want you to go with me to the Gospel according to Luke, Luke chapter 2 with me, if you would. I'm really glad that you're here today. I'm really glad we're starting this series today called The Highest. Because I want us to lift Jesus up higher and higher and higher in this house. And I want to see Jesus lifted up so high in your life. We're going to begin this journey on a night a long, long time ago on a field near Bethlehem. Luke chapter 2, beginning with verse 8, the Bible says that there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today, in the town of David, the Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You'll find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." What an incredible sight that must have been that night. I mean, here are these shepherds, the commonest of people, watching sheep, doing what they do night in and night out. And these are probably the lowest shepherds on the totem pole. It looks like they've got the midnight shift watching sheep. And here they are watching these sheep and eating pork and beans. How many of you know what I'm talking about? This is what they do. When all of a sudden the sky lights up and there's an angel in front of them. And they were absolutely terrified. The Bible says they were terrified. These were the very first Quakers. How many of you know what I'm talking about? They're going, they're shaking all over. They're looking at this angel. And I'm sure what's going through their mind is, we're going to die tonight. I mean, right here on the side of this mountain, we're going to die. Never seen anything like this before. The angel looks at them and he says, "Don't be afraid." It was a night that would prove to be filled with the highest glory, and a night that would prove to be filled with the deepest peace. God's glory was on display in a nearby manger and in the skies around that place. The Bible tells us that when those angels that had announced, and I mean, you got to just in your mind get this deep sense of the awe and the majesty of that night. I mean, first there's one angel, but then the skies are full. And they're screaming out, "Glory, glory, glory to God in the highest. Peace on earth to men." The Bible tells us that when the angels had left, the shepherds hurried off to Bethlehem to find Mary and Joseph, and of course the one that the angel had told them about, the Savior, Jesus Christ, the baby who was lying in that manger. Now these shepherds were despised. History tells us, culture from then tells us that they were some of the most despised people. They were about as low on the totem pole as you could get. They were most despised by religious leaders and by the religious community. Their work of watching over the flocks kept them from most, if not all, religious activities in their community. But tonight, they didn't have to go looking for God in some religious community, because on this night, God brought His glory so close to them, and He invited them to come and have a face-to-face as He displayed His glory in, of all places, a feed trough, a manger. There's a couple of things on that night that I want you to see about these shepherds. One was that they were overcome, overwhelmed with the need and the desire to go and see, to go and find this Christ child, to find this Savior and to worship Him. And they did just that. In all of their days, they had probably never been invited to a religious service or a religious moment. And this was not going to be a religious moment. This was going to be a life-changing event. As they went to that place where they found Mary and Joseph and baby Jesus, and they beheld His glory, they had never in their lifetime been invited to come as close to God. The other thing that I see in their life is a deep, deep sense of peace that filled their hearts. We know, the Bible tells us, that when the first angel showed up and began to make the announcement, they were terrified, they were scared. That's a common way to react. How many of you, if an angel showed up at your house tonight, in the middle of the night, how many of you would freak out? Some of you would dial 911. Hi, I have a glowing figure in my bedroom. Others of you would attempt to shoot the angel. How many of you understand what I'm saying? You would just, you know, pull out your gun and probably shoot yourself in the process. Not too many of you would go, "Oh, honey, look, it's an angel. Wake up, let's get some coffee. Maybe we can talk a little while." Most of you would do what I would probably do. I would probably get up and take off running as fast as I could if my feet and legs would still work. I would be freaking out. I mean, that would be a sight. It would just blow you away. And throughout the Bible, almost every encounter we read between mankind and angels, we read that people saw and they spoke with these angels. They were filled with fear. They were overwhelmed with emotion at the sight and the experience. And we know even these shepherds weren't initially that way, but something happened. Something happened. Because they went from terrified to absolutely overcome with a holy curiosity that they had to go find. They believed what the angel said, and they had to go find, and they had to go see this Christ child for themselves. You see, I believe this Christmas that God wants Jesus Christ to be lifted to the highest place He can be in your life, to the place of highest honor, the place of highest glory, the place of highest majesty. He is worthy. None other is worthy to be lifted high. There is no name in heaven or in earth or under the earth that is greater than the name of Jesus Christ. He deserves to be lifted to the place of highest. If you were to go before a king or a queen, in even our present world, the correct way to announce your arrival or to speak to them would be to call them not by their first name, not by their given name, not by their last name, but you might call them a highness. It's so good to be in your presence. But I want to say to you that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the Bible says, is the King of kings and the Lord of lords, and there is none higher than Jesus Christ. And I believe this Christmas God wants us to lift Him up to the highest place, and then I believe that God wants to fill us with the deepest of peace. You see, those angels were doing what God created them to do that night, as they said glory, glory to God in the highest. They were worshiping His majesty. When those shepherds found Him asleep, just as the angel said they would, in that manger, they came to worship Him. The truth is, we were all created to worship. When God made us, He made us with an inner desire to worship something or someone.
The truth is, you cannot help yourself. You are going to want to worship something. You're going to worship someone. It's going to happen in your life because that is a part of how God created you. The unfortunate part is not everybody worships God. Some people worship cars. Some worship sports. Some people worship fashion or design. Others worship nature. I am blown away this time of the year by how many even Christians lose the focus of what Christmas is all about. And I meet Christians this time of the year who, instead of worshiping Christ, they worship Christmas. Amen? I mean, we worship Christmas. I mean, we go all out. We decorate. We bake. We eat fruitcake. I mean, doorstops. Amen. That's it. And we go around. We're so excited. It's Christmas. It's the most wonderful time of the year. We're awake now. Amen. And we worship Christmas. I want to tell you, you were made to worship Jesus Christ alone. God made you. He designed you to be a worshiper. Nothing else will fill the void in your life. As human beings, we cannot help but assign ultimate value and worth to someone or something. But I want to challenge you this Christmas to assign ultimate worth and value to none other than Jesus Christ. Our heart has got to be to see the glory of God. I want to behold His glory. I want to see Him high and lifted up this Christmas. Now, what is this whole idea of God's glory? What does it mean? What is God's glory? Well, I believe the glory of God, I believe a good definition of the glory of God is who He is. It's who He is. It's how He thinks. It's how He feels. It's what He does. It's who He is. The glory of God is who He is. It's His perfection. It's His personality. It's His presence. It's His character. The glory of God is how God thinks. It's His plans. It's His purposes for the universe, for history, for you, for me. It's how God feels. It's His deepest passion, His grace, His mercy, His love. It's what He does. It's His power, His presence, His promises. The glory of God is simply who God is. And as I read the Bible and as I study throughout the Old Testament, the New Testament, what I find is God has been on this journey with mankind. And what He's been trying to do, and what He's still trying to do, is reveal His glory to man. God wants us to be exposed to the highest glory, to the glory of God, so that we will be changed. He wants to come close to us, and He invites us, as He did those shepherds, to come close to Him, that at the sight of the glory of God, we would be filled with the deepest sense of peace. The Bible says that God, over a period of thousands of years, has revealed Himself to us a little bit at a time, a little more each time. You know God far better than Moses knew God, or Abraham knew God, because God has come closer, and he's peeled back the layers, and He's revealed Himself more and more. As I read the Word of God, I find several occasions where God displayed His glory, where He was attempting to reveal His glory to mankind. The first, of course, was at creation. When God created the earth, and He created the heavens, and everything there in them, you see a reflection of God. You don't have to look any further than nature to see that God is creative and that God is organized and how powerful He is. And He's a God of variety. I mean, just look around in here at all the funny looking people in this room and you'll just know He's a God of variety. Amen? The funny thing is they're looking at you thinking you're funny looking. Amen? If you look at the skies at night, the stars, the mountains, the ocean, a waterfall, a flower growing in your backyard, you can see the glory of God. The next time you witness a sunset or a sunrise, you can see in that the very glory of God. Everything in the universe is designed to bring glory to God. When you see a bird sitting on a wire singing, he's doing that birdly thing of bringing glory to God. When you see a lizard Many of you know, I know when Christmas is coming. When I lived in Virginia, it would get cold and start snowing. Not here, although I'm praying for snow. How many of you are in agreement with me? I'm not going home for Christmas this year. This is my home, and I'm here for Christmas, and I'm praying for a couple of inches of snow in Palm Beach County. I think it would be just... We're too agree touching anything. Snow for the kids. Amen. Amen. There's snow already. Amen. But I know it's almost Christmas time in Palm Beach County when the lizards start wearing Santa hats. How many of you know what I'm talking about? When those lizards, as ugly as they are out there doing their lizardy thing.
And God said, you know what?
I guess I'm going to have to display my glory again. I guess I'm going to have to show this Pharaoh a thing or two. So God revealed His glory by doing a series of miracles, which ended up being 10 plagues. And eventually, the Pharaoh lets the Israelites go, and they head across the Sinai Peninsula to go to the Promised Land. How many of you know you're getting education in the Old Testament the rapid-fire way? According to historians, and you don't have to be a historian or a theologian to figure this out, it's about 150 miles from where they were released in Egypt to where the Promised Land was. It should have taken 2 weeks walking distance to get there. Instead, it didn't take 2 weeks, it took 40 years. I mean, you, that kind of sounds like your journey, amen? We're kind of stubborn sometimes too. God would test the faith of the Jews, and they would fail the test. And the Lord would go, okay, one more lap around the desert, and we'll give you the test again. And they'd give them the test again, and they'd fail it. And He'd go, okay, one more lap around the desert. And 40 years later, they made it to the Promised Land. While they were out there, Moses goes up to Mount Sinai. God gives him the Ten Commandments, the laws of God that are going to be the basis of the Jewish nation of Israel, and the law for all of us, and the moral law of the world. I just want to remind you, murder is a capital offense in these United States of America. And I want to remind you that no politician in America came up with that law. That is a law of God. Thou shalt not kill. That was God's law. That's where that came from. Moses is up there. And while he's up there, he asks God for a favor. He says, God, I want to see your glory. In Exodus 33, Moses said, please show me your glory. And God says, Moses, nobody could stand to see my face directly and live. But my glory will pass by your cave, and I'll cover it with my hand. And after I've passed by, I'll remove my hand so you can see my back. And the Bible says that Moses got this tiniest, this slightest glimpse, like no human being on earth up to that time. He got this glimpse of God's greatness and God's glory and God's brightness and God's brilliance. And actually, as you read that story, we don't have time to unpack it. It was so powerful, such a moment in the presence of God, that it rubbed off on Moses. And when he came down from the mountain, he was actually glowing. If you'd have turned the lights off, you'd have had a glow-in-the-dark Moses. The Bible says he literally, the Israelites said, put a veil on your face. We can't stand to look at you. You're too bright. Amen. And this is probably where sunglasses were first invented. Amen. And he puts a veil on his face. But if you read that story, you'll find that long after the glory was gone, the veil was still on. How many of you know that we do the same thing today? We still try to act religious long after we've grown cold towards the Lord. So that's another example of the glory of God. For 40 years they're in the wilderness. They wanted a place to worship. So God said, okay, go ahead and build a tabernacle. We studied this on Wednesday night several months ago. Studied for weeks on this tabernacle. It was a tent. It was a tent where they would come and meet with God. It was a place so they would know that God was with them. The Bible says, when they finished that tabernacle, at last Moses finished the work, then a cloud covered the tabernacle. And the glorious presence of the Lord filled it. And the tabernacle was filled with the awesome glory of the Lord. And so God again is displaying His glory. God came down to that tabernacle. He habitated. He tabernacled with His people. He lived among them because He wanted to be close. Listen to me. He's always wanted to be close. From the Garden of Eden to the tabernacle, He's always wanted to move in a little closer. He's wanted to reveal, to display His highest glory to man. He wants us to see who He is. The Bible tells us eventually the Jews did get to go to the Promised Land. And after they got there, they began saying, we need a temple. God said, you don't need a temple. I don't live in buildings. But they insisted, we need a temple. And if you know, God gives us things sometimes that we don't necessarily need because we're hard-headed. How many of you understand? God gave them a temple. And the Bible says in 1 Kings that at the dedication of the temple, as the priests came out of the inner sanctuary, a cloud filled the temple of the Lord, and the priests could not continue to work because of the glorious presence of the Lord filled the temple. And in that temple, in Jerusalem, the power and presence of God, the glory of God was in that place. And yet God's people turned against him.
I don't have time to unpack all of this for your own self. If you read it for yourself in the book of Ezekiel, Ezekiel mentions a vision from God where he saw the glory of God leaving. There's a statement in the book of Ezekiel, I believe it is, in the Hebrew, the word is Ichabod. And it means the glory of God has departed. He's gone. For 400 years, there was no presence, no glory of God among his people.
From the last prophetic word in the Old Testament to the first fulfillment in the very first word in the New Testament, there's a period of 400 years called the intertestament time. It's those 400 years between the Old Testament and the New Testament. For 400 years, nobody really was close to God. Nobody was really hearing God's voice. And God's presence wasn't there. But then finally, in the fulfillment of God's plan, God said, I'm coming back. I'm going to one more time reveal my glory to man. Only this time, I'm not going to just show up in a flower. I'm not going to show up in a building. I'm not going to put my presence in a tent. He said, this time, I'm going to put my presence in a person. I'm coming personally to earth in human form, and you'll see my glory that way. And who I'm talking about is none other than Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. Born of a virgin, Jesus laying in a manger, the glory of God. And at that very first Christmas, as Jesus is born, and I don't know this for a fact, but I can't help but think that at that very moment, I mean, you got an angel out here and he's making a birth announcement. Now, shepherd dudes, listen to me. If you'll go over to Bethlehem, you're going to see the glory of God. Now, let me tell you what you're going to find. There's going to be there a baby. He's wrapped in swaddling clothes. He's lying in this feed trough. He's making this announcement when all of a sudden the choir shows up. This is just my own personal theology, okay? Don't go home and tell people that Pastor Mike said the Bible says this, because the Bible doesn't say this. It's my own personal theology. I think that may have been the very moment of his birth as those angels broke through the skies and said, glory, 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 the glory is back, glory to God in the highest. Right now. Shh. Can I tell you something? That is the greatest revelation of God's glory in all of history, greater than creation, greater than Eden, greater than the Exodus out of Egypt, greater than the fact that God put his presence in a tent, greater than his presence in a place called the temple. It's the glory of God that is on display in the life of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the full revelation of God's glory. Now, I want you very quickly to go with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I'm going to try to wrap this up, put a nice bow on this, and try to bring this home for you. What does this mean to us right now, right here, right now? You see, listen to me. You've done this. I've done this way too many times. We come to the house of God like we did this morning. We sit, we listen. The preacher gets all excited, almost has a heart attack. We egg him on, go, yeah. And then we walk out those doors and it doesn't change us one iota. We're the same person that we were when we walked in the doors. I believe that God wants to change us. Yeah. Listen to me. If you will seek him, you will find him. If you will seek him, you will find him, just like the wise men found him, just like the shepherds found him. If you'll seek him, you'll find him. And when you find him, if you'll look, you'll see his glory. And listen to me, if you see his glory, you cannot be the same person that you are. Paul wrote these words in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, beginning in verse 1. Well, let's go down to verse 4. Paul said, the God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not preach ourselves, Paul says, but Christ Jesus as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. Look at verse 6. For God, who said, let light shine out of darkness, made His light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. What in the world is Paul saying? Paul is saying that God has made a deposit in the heart of believers, and that deposit is the very person of Jesus Christ. The very Spirit of God is in your life. The glory of God is on display in your life. God has filled you. My friends, if you're a believer, He has filled you with the glory of God. This morning in the first service, we had two people respond to the altar call. One, I believe she gave her heart and life to Jesus for the very first time. And the young man that I prayed with rededicated his heart and life to Jesus Christ. And I want to tell you right now, the glory of God overtook them. Can you identify with what I'm saying? Do you understand what I'm telling you? If you're a believer, how many believers do I have here this morning? If you're a child of God, how many children of the Lord do I have here this morning? The glory of God is in your life. At home in my bathroom, when you walk into the left side of the counter, is my toothbrush. And my toothbrush has a friend. And his friend is called toothpaste. How many of y'all have some toothpaste that lives in your mouth? Now, I've not lost my mind, just hang with me. When I pick up that tube of toothpaste, and I do this a couple, three times a day, when I squeeze it, whatever's inside of it comes out. Now, I've never done this. The next time I go to my mother-in-law's house, I think I might try this. Working off of the theory that whatever's in it will come out when you squeeze it, I might put something else in hers. Amen. You know, a hot sauce comes to mind. Super glue comes to mind. I don't know. Pray for me. Just pray for me. The point being, whatever's in it, when it's squeezed, comes out. Guess what? Whatever's in you, when you're squeezed, comes out. Hello? Want to know what's inside? Let me squeeze you a little bit. How do we get squeezed? Let me tell you. Pressure. Stress. Christmas shopping. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Hello? When you're in the hall and you prayed before you went, oh dear God, please give me a parking space. Just know that everybody else prayed the same prayer. And you see one, and you're just, it's yours. You waved at the person as they put their little blinker on, and they put it up in the park, or the back up, and they're doing this, and you know, it's just like, come on, anytime before, you know, Easter would be great. And they back in the car out, and you're sitting there, because you're so happy, it's your parking spot. When Pastor Craig pulls in his red sports car and beats you to the parking spot. Oh, that's called being squeezed. When your boss tells you, you know, those Christmas bonuses that we've been handing out, we ain't giving none this year. And you get squeezed. When those people that you're related to invite themselves over to your house for Christmas dinner, you get squeezed. I think you know what I'm talking about. And when you're squeezed, whatever is on the inside of you comes out. Let me read verses 8 and 9. Interesting. Paul says we're hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. Let me ask you a question. When does God show up best in your life? When is the glory of God pop out of your head, when you can't figure it out, when you're over the top, underwater, going down for the last time, ready to throw in the towel, when you are stressed out, God says, that's when I want to show my glory most in your life to other people. Basically, let me tell you what you are. The Bible says you are a clay jar. Look at your neighbor and say, you're a clay jar. Tell him, you're a good-looking clay jar. You're a jar clay. Let me give you a modern-day translation for that. You are Tupperware. Amen. That's exactly what you are. You're Tupperware. You're a God container. I mean, you understand this. You are a God container. Paul says we're pressed on every side by trouble. Anybody relate to that? Can you relate to that? We are perplexed. What does that mean? In other words, we're confused. We have the slightest idea why this is going on in our life. I can't figure it out. I don't know why things are happening the way that they're happening. We're perplexed. But we don't give up and quit. We're hunted down, he says. But God never abandons us. We get knocked down, but we're not knocked out, so that the life of Jesus may be revealed in our lives. On that night, as those angels broke that silence with that chorus, glory, glory, glory to God in the highest, they also said, and peace on earth to men. Because with the expression of God's glory comes a deep sense of peace. And when we have that peace from the Lord, the glory of God can shine and be shone through in our lives. Listen to it. The practical application of what we've talked about this morning is twofold. Number one, God wants you, like those angels, like those shepherds, like those wise men, like Mary and Joseph, like all of those people on that very first Christmas that had their eyes open and were looking for Him. God wants you to see His glory on display this Christmas to the highest level, and that is in the person of Jesus Christ. Listen, whatever else you do or don't do this Christmas, you need to worship the Lord. I had some people this week that told me, said, Pastor, I won't be able to be in church Sunday. Okay. So I've got shopping to do, I've got baking to do, I've got all kinds of things to do. I said, that's okay. Better keep you focused on Jesus. Hello? I said, you better keep you focused on Jesus. Now, you don't have to be in this building to keep you focused on Jesus. That's not the point I'm trying to make. I'm just trying to say, you need to look for His glory. You need to make sure that whatever you do this Christmas, you worship Him. You give Him the highest glory. Excuse me. And seven, you can trust God that He'll give you the deepest of peace right now in your heart. I'm going to invite you across this room to bow your heads and close your eyes. We're going to pray. And I'm praying that you will experience the glory of God in the highest. And I'm praying that you will experience peace on earth, peace in your heart, peace of mind, peace in your family. That God will give you the deepest of peace. And I believe that no matter what you're facing or what you're going through or what you're up against, that peace will be enough as you focus on the glory of God. Don't miss that this Christmas. Don't let your family miss that this Christmas. You know, I challenged the group that was here last night for worship that just as we had communion a few minutes ago, that'd be a great tradition to start in your house this Christmas. You put the tree up and bake all the cookies and drink all the eggnog, but how about taking a moment and reading the Christmas story and maybe having a time of communion and remembering what the Lord has done for you and opening the greatest gift that's ever been given before your family and reminding them that Jesus is the gift. I'm going to invite you to bow your head and close your eyes right now, and as you do, I want to ask you to do two things. Number one, if you're a believer in this house, you're already in Jesus, I want you right now just to begin to focus on the Lord and just begin to say, Lord, I want to see your glory. I want to see your glory. I want to see you high and lifted up. Would you do that right now? Would you just begin to focus on Him and just begin to worship Him right now if you're a believer in this house? You might be here this morning and you don't know Him. You're not walking with Him. He invites you today to come and see His glory. The glory of God on display in the face of Jesus Christ. And He'll change your life. He will change your life. He'll make all things new.
you'll let it today, the greatest thing that's ever happened to you will happen. And that is the glory of God. We believe that you will be changed. So believers, Christians, right now, would you take a moment as we're in His presence, would you begin right now in your own way to just worship Him and thank Him and praise Him and tell Him you want to see His glory. And begin to receive His deepest peace this morning. Would you do that? Oh God, we need your peace. Lord, we want to worship you, lift you high. Glory to you, Lord Jesus. There's none higher than you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Watched them differently. They may have went back to their old job, but I'm going to tell you something. I believe believe they had a glorious celebration. I believe they had church in the field every night as they worshiped the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and His Majesty. Their life was changed, and our lives will be changed if we'll accept His invitation to come a little bit closer and to see Him face to face. I want to encourage you to do that. We're going to pray for these folks. And as you feel like you're done, you can be dismissed. Please do so quietly, because there are people who are still soaking in the presence of the Lord, and they're still just basking in His presence. So be respectful. But we're going to do this, and we're going to take it up a notch next week. And come the 22nd and 23rd, before Christmas, we're going to take it all the way to the rafters, because we're going to exalt Him to the highest place. Amen.
I love you guys.
Amen.